BeeGees&Me in the British top 10, I think it is, at any one time. Their Saturday Night Fever soundtrack is the highest-selling soundtrack of all time. Tonight, the Bee Gees, one of the great five groups, speak to us about music, about fame, families, life. This in a few minutes. Are the fifth biggest selling recording stars of all time. They come in just behind the Beatles, Elvis Presley, Michael Jackson, and one other whose name I can't remember because I lost the bit of paper. I'll try and find out before the end of the program. But I mean, they're that big. They're the only recording artist to have written and sung six straight number one singles. They have earned 16 Grammy nominations. They have won seven Grammys. Their first hit was right back in 1966, over 30 years ago. They're the only group to have top 10 singles in each of four decades. The soundtrack of Saturday Night Fever, as I say, the biggest selling soundtrack of all time. They keep writing wonderful songs, different types of songs. Their music evolves over the years. They're huge. The Bee Gees are huge. And next March, they're in Auckland. The show they're taking around the world to select venues is called One Night Only. Barry, Robin and Morris Gibb live in Miami. It might be Elton John, but I don't think it is Elton John. We got them into a studio in Miami to talk to us about their tour, about their lives, how they've handled the success, their music, and why the Bee Gees still rock.
What I want to do?
What? You know what I want to do?
What?
Strut.
Got me loud and clear.
Yep.
Morris, you got me loud and clear.
Yep.
And Robin, you got me loud and clear. Good on you. Okay, here we go. So it was One Night Only. When you recorded One Night Only in Las Vegas, was that, you know, a coming together where you suddenly could say to each other, gosh, we've missed this. We haven't done, you know, it's been too long since we did this kind of thing. Is this why the world tour?
I think most of it is we've always performed, even when we're in the studio, we're sort of performing together. But the only reason we hadn't been touring that much is because of making the album. And so that was about 18 months. So we had a lot of time working and writing. Also, we were writing for other people, things like that. So we had a commitment to other artists to write songs for. And so our time was caught up pretty busily.
Because you see, apart from being artists and performers, we're also recording artists and songwriters. And yeah. Producers and we
brain
surgeons on the weekend.
Proctologists.
And these things have to be taken into account, and you have to sort of weave in and out. If you're touring all the time, you can't be writing for other people, you can't be making records.
And you're patient.
And you're patient waiting.
Yeah. Was there ever a period, really, since the late 70s, that you've had to struggle professionally? I mean, was there something of a hiatus for the Bee Gees from the late 60s through to the late 80s until Saturday Night Fever came along?
No. Well, I mean, obviously, it would be easy to say there were no problems at all, but every group has problems, and we had our share of them. Morris had personal problems. I had back problems. We all have children. So there you are. So it's just the way life is, you know. Our lives can't be according to how everybody else would like it to be.
I think if you look at everybody's careers, from whether it's Cliff Richard or Elton John or Rod Stewart,
Roddy Bailey,
Elton John, people like that. And you look back, and anybody with long careers don't always have it the way they want it.
Sorry.
There's always going to be moments where they could personally be more satisfied with what's going on.
Yeah.
But that's part of having a long career.
How many children between you?
105.
Well, we've never had any children between us. I mean, that's a...
Oh, yeah, so we don't do together.
Really. Okay. We all have our own delegation. Go ahead.
Yeah, I have a boy and a girl, Adam and Samantha, 22 and 18 years old.
I've got three children, Spencer, Melissa and Robin John.
And I have five children. Hang on, give me five. Stephen, Ashley, Travis, Michael, and Alexandra, our first little girl. So we had four boys in a row and then a little girl.
And so how many of these kids of the BeeGees want to be musicians, want to be performing stars like their fathers?
Every one of them, I think.
Well, they're all into music. So,
yeah, they all love music. And my kids particularly are writing, and they're doing demos right now, and my daughter sings.
And my son, Spencer, has a band in Austin. But the one thing we're not doing is we're not always pressing them to do what we do. If they do it organically, that's fine.
Yeah, nobody pressed us. Nobody forced
us
to do.
They did, but with their shoes.
Yes. we always we've just always enjoyed doing it, and I think that has to be in them as well as kids. Yeah. It has something they want to do.
The spunk has to be there.
When we come back to the Bee Gees, four decades they've been going. They're still at the top. Where do they find the inspiration? Why do they still bother? More of Barry, Morris, and Robin Gibb in a few minutes.
Move over, Robin Hood. Rook.
You've had number one records, you've had number one singles in the United Kingdom charts in over four decades. I mean, over four decades. That must be a matter of considerable pride. Or does it scare you?
It certainly is. Yeah. No, we're very proud. We're very proud. Yes, it scares us in a sense that we really never believed that we'd still be doing what we're doing and enjoying it as much as we are. Mm. So, yes, it's something to be very proud of.
We're enjoying our career today more than any other time. In our career.
Because there's a bit more experience,
apart from the fact there's no alternative, we're enjoying it very much.
Yeah.
He's given up his paper round.
When you look back at all of the songs, when you look back at all the performances, all the number one records, all the gold records and so forth, why did the Bee Gees song strike such a chord with so many people right around the world, do you think?
We could all have a separate guess, but I think it's the melodies.
Yes.
That we tend to come up with, and without really knowing where they come from, it's the melodies as such. And I think that our sound, as three brothers, has really weathered over the years. People like that.
I think there's also an emotional value to the songs, which a lot of artists don't use, and we use a lot of emotion in our songs. And as Barry said, harmonies and
we're romantics. Yeah.
Yeah. And they strike a chord with people. And this is kind of universal. And there are countries where they don't even understand the words, where they hear the emotional value, but they don't understand the words.
And they will sing along, like in China.
I heard one of you once, you were being interviewed about Saturday Night Fever, you talked about how the song Jive Talking came about, Jive Talking.
The bridge.
The bridge in New Orleans, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Can you tell us about that?
No, it was here in Miami.
It was here in Miami, and we were making regular drives to Miami Beach from a studio called Criteria, which is a very famous studio here, in the time of Fever, before Fever, in fact. And there was a bridge between home and the studio that had a clickety-clackety sound. It was like every night we would hear this and going home. And it just became Jive Talking. Every night we would start singing a little bit of it, and we'd go with that rhythm every night. Every time we heard the bridge, that's Jive Talking.
The money. I mean, there must be an awful lot of money now. The money must be an awful lot of money now, and it must have been very hard to learn to manage that much money. But of course, you're musicians, you're songwriters, you're singers, you're performers.
It's easy.
Is it really easy to manage?
We surely must be lawyers as well.
We're actually accountants before we were actually pop stars.
Well, a bit like Mick Jagger. He was an economist. He got a degree in economy at school, yeah.
No, he went to the London School of Economics.
Never. That's right.
Yes, there you go.
We've never been experts in money, but we've always had, for 25 years, we've had the best advisors in the world. We think we have. Our attorney is a British attorney. We don't have any other attorneys. He's our international attorney.
And no matter what, we still get our £25 a week.
He's an international man of mystery.
I mean, you seem very happy people. I mean, some people could be as successful as you and simply think, well, I've done it all now. What God's name do I do?
Miserable sons, yeah.
Yes, could be miserable.
Yeah, I don't know. I think we just count our blessings that everything has gone as well for us and what we've done and what we're doing, you know, because we're very fortunate, you know, to be blessed with what we do and to do what we love.
You mentioned that there have been ups and downs and things like that. Well, I think those are the things that have kept us going.
Yeah.
As opposed to always having good things, you know, I think... Yeah. You have to have a roller coaster ride.
I think it was the depression and the bounce in the asylum that did it. But after that, everything seemed rosy. Electroshock therapy.
The electroshock treatment worked a treat. There's no question about that.
Are you better now than you ever were, do you think?
Oh, since the treatment, yes.
Are you saying that we are, or are you making that up? Or are you asking us if we think we are?
I think that you are probably better than you ever were, and I think you've written some beautiful songs, and the people can't wait to see you.
Thank you very much. It's very nice.
Oh, you're very kind, Paul.
Thank you all.
So aren't they wonderful, the Bee Gees, Barry Morris and Robin Gibb, and I understand there was a big run on tickets for the Bee Gees today, still quite a few available. I think the second best category of tickets sold out today. I still can't find out who the fourth biggest selling artist of all time is. We've searched through the old, you know, the internet and the pages and the home pages and the fan club pages and so forth, but I know that really only the Beatles, Elvis and Michael Jackson are ahead of the Bee Gees in terms of record sales. The Bee Gees have sold 105 million album, so that would make a very nice house, I would think, very nice accommodation in Miami. They're coming here in March, and really, we're very lucky, I suppose, if you're a fan of the Bee Gees, because they're only doing about 6 dates around the world. I think they're playing Cape Town, they're playing Dublin, they're playing Wembley. They are going after this to the Olympic Stadium in Sydney, which would be a magnificent concert, would it not? So the Bee Gees are on their way. Interesting, too, how they all end up, even at their age, living in the same city. They must have decided to base themselves in Miami, and that's where they work, and they write, and they do their stuff. And, of course, they're covered, some of their songs, too, by some of their idols, I suppose, have decided to record their songs as well, which must be a tremendous tribute. Those were our people today. That's Holmes tonight.